And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Blind, I'm the RPG chick. Off screen, I rested. I think I was going to do that between episodes 29 and 30. You know, between last episode and the one before, but I think I forgot. So, I think I planned on doing it. But anyway, now we're completely rested up. All our hit points back. Some of us were kind of screwed up. I think Tybear had like 8 hit points or something, so he's like perfectly fine now.
Allow me.
So we're gonna talk to these guys, the thugs and the Fulsom. I don't think Fulsom is very wholesome. Hail, thug. Keep your distance, plotter. You're out of your turret, tiny. You mean turf? This man towers over you, enormously fat and draped in gaudy robes. His expression is calm, stern even, as he regards the bloody mess spread across the floor and wall. The hooded figures on either side of him tense as you approach. He turns to inspect you, eyebrow lifted, and raises his hand. His bodyguards relax, watching you. In the space of a second, his eyes flick over you. He nods, apparently to himself, as if your presence has confirmed something he expected. And he thinks, one of the cast-off godlings. That explains the missing pieces. What are you doing in the underbelly, falling star? Who are you? The people of the underbelly struggle, he says after a long pause. They live and die in the dark. Their sorrows do not reach the ears of those who live in the light. The reflection of your face is a pale circle in his dark eyes. And so, I speak for them before the mighty. Protect them from the predators that see them as easy prey, and... He pauses, pressing his lips together. I avenge them when I fail. He folds his arms. Now answer my question. Why are you here? I'm looking for someone. Are you? He says. I know everyone in the underbelly, and I am seeking someone as well. Perhaps we can help each other.
I'll remember that.
He turns his back on you, staring down at the vast pool of blood. What's cool is that he actually did just that. This is all that remains of Weedle, one of my proteges. I had hopes for him. Now they will never be realized. The underbelly is poorer without him. The rage beneath his voice cuts each word shorter and shorter. Bring me any information you find. Help me discover the identity of his killer, and you will be rewarded. He exhales sharply, then turns around. The fury you glimpsed in him is buried once more. You can turn around.
I'll remember that.
Oh, there he goes. There is an assassin named Matkina. She is known as the White Death. I have helped her find work in the past, but she has become erratic. If she is not involved, she might know who is. If you wish to help in this matter, ask her what she knows. The creature named Mapper may know where she is. I've already met Mapper. I'll find out where Matkina is hiding. I will observe your investigation with great interest. Do you have any ideas about the killer's motive? I have suspicions, he says, a muscle on his cheek twitching. And I have enemies. It takes no imagination to conclude that this was meant to hurt me. He shakes his head. But the killer did not slit Weedle's throat and leave him for me to find. No, they spilled an ocean of his blood and scrawled nonsense on the walls. If this is a message for me, I cannot interpret it. He thinks. It suggests the killer is crazy. But which of my enemies are insane? I'm going to try to remember this symbol. Looks like something exploding outward, right? Or a head of like a bird with like feathers. Kind of like a not Woody the Woodpecker, but like a spy versus spy kind of thing. And then like two like balls there, and Okay. If this murder was intended to hurt me, it has succeeded. If it was meant to send a message, it failed. I'm gonna save that for last. Do you live in the underbelly? Not quite. He smiles like he's paying for it by the millimeter. I rarely sleep, so I need no bed of my own. But I have spent most of my life in these tunnels and grottos. It's a good place. Cruel and unforgiving, but good. His slow gaze sweeps over the underbelly. Sagus foolishly sends its undesirables here, as if it is worthless. But the underbelly is a place of hidden treasures, wise machines, and kind mutants. If I had a home here, I would not regret it. Fulsom seems like a strange... I don't have an option to ask him the other thing. Oh, we don't have... It just says what they say and not the menus. Right. Fulsom seems like a strange name for you. Yes, the big man says. The name was a gift, and somewhat of a witticism, from my departed mentor many years ago. Before long, the name was the only one I was known by. He thinks, a true gift in light of the unfortunate nature of my given name. I want to examine the murder scene behind you. At first, Fulsom doesn't respond. He merely stares down at you, through you. I will not have you trample through his blood without cause, he says at last, so there had better be one. He thinks, I don't need your help that badly, Godling. Too bad the option went away. I don't get to ask him, how he knows who I am. I know you are grieving for your protege. All I want is to catch his killer. Red Tide. See, every time I think it would be a gold one. Unblinking, he regards you, his face a stoic mask, an iron wall. Finally, he nods. See, I would think it would be gold-tied because I was, you know, I was kind of caring there, right? I know you're grieving, I understand, all this stuff. Oh, but whatever. Let her pass when she is ready, he tells the hooded figures at his side. They incline their heads. Farewell. Alright, let's... investigate.
Let's go.
Not much remains of Fulsom's former protege beyond a vast still pool of blood with a skinned hand at its center. I didn't notice the hand. A bloody circle is scrawled on the wall nearby. Let's examine the bloody circle. Mystical lore, cool. You study the dashes and bleeding pinpricks decorating, binding the circle. They aren't symbols in any known human tongue, but you sense their purpose. The circle was almost inconsequential. These sigils gripped the shape of it and pushed it through time and space. There was, however, briefly, a trans-dimensional portal to another place. Now it is dead. This is more than just some mad scrawling. The sigils gripped the shape of it and pushed it through time and space. Transdimensional portal. So did whoever did this fled through the portal? Or came in through the portal? Or both? Before you can look away from the circle, a memory bulges painfully through your thoughts, and the memory isn't yours. Surrender to the memory now, no matter how much it hurts. Fresh blood streams over the circle, yanking you through the hollow at its center into the world beyond. A strip of blistered land coils through a void as black as a gaping mouth. The air is thick, foul, and textured with the sick slickness of maggots. Nausea slams into you, filling your head, infecting your thoughts. I lost 2 hit points, I think. But I gained 2 XP. Yeah, 2 damage. You shove the horrific memory away from you, slamming your mind shut like a door, and swallowing the knot of nausea in your throat. After seeing that world, the bloody pool at your feet seems almost mundane. If anything, the circle on the wall, the trans-dimensional gate, seems dimmer than it was before. Let's inspect the hand in the pool of blood. A flayed hand with long, slender fingers lies palm up in the center of the pool of blood. The rest of the victim is missing.
Making a note.
You step away. The fingers of the skinned hand at the center of the pool have curled slightly, but the scene is otherwise unchanged. Alright, what are these notes we have? Discover the location of the Changing God's Sanctuary from Mapper. A mutant named Mapper claims to know where Matkina is hiding. He'll only reveal what he knows if I can find a hidden sanctuary that was established long ago by the Changing God. Apparently, it's the one important site in Sega's cliffs that Mapper hasn't yet located. All he knows is that it's underground, somewhere very close to the Stitcher Lair. Okay, circles in red. A murderer is loose in Underbelly, the poorest and foulest ward in Sega's cliffs. If the culprit isn't caught soon, more people are likely to die. Fulsom asked me to bring him any information I can find, but he didn't provide much in the way of leads. Fulsom suspects the involvement of Matkina, the so-called White Death, who is an assassin of some repute. He asked me to question her. He isn't sure where Matkina is, but a mutant called Mapper might know. Fulsom let me inspect the sign of his protege's murder. The body was nowhere to be found, only a single hand and a strange circle drawn on the wall in blood.
Calisteges?
Calistege.
Calistege.
How would you like it if I called you Eretuses?
Oh. I would like that very much.
At least I know I was saying Eretus right. Anything more to say, Fulsom? Nope. Alright.
Allow me.
Any more from Mapper? Probably not. Maybe I can ask him about the murder, if he saw anything. Have you found it yet? Do you see with new eyes? Have you heard anything about the murders down here? Murders? What murders? Alarm colors his face, and a faint red streak runs through his tattoos. No one tells me anything. One of the drawbacks of being a drifter, I suppose. No one thinks to keep you informed. Then he looks around. Of course, in a place like this, people don't generally talk to each other much anyway. Farewell. Travel well, my friend. So I want to ask the meat guy now. You ain't on the scrounge, are you? Ain't enough here for both of us. A swollen mass of wet glistening muscle quivers in the vat. That's the thing we were looking at. And this vat is filled with wriggling reptilian tails, knotted and tangled together. And then this thing, these are the three meats he has. Hundreds of leathery wings flutter against each other like they're trying to escape. They grow haphazardly, one sprouting from the next. Insane. Meat, meat, meat. Let's see if we can ask him about the murders. Kind of meaty, so... No, we don't have the option. I've already asked him these questions. Just because they're paranoid doesn't mean they're not out to get you. Manufactory worker. Go bother someone else. Snickers. Varanoth. Let's see if Varanoth has anything to say. Nope. And I'm gone again.
Go.
So I really can't really see much of this water. Crooked Qeek?
We shall see.
And then someone's fishing over there. A small, hollow-cheeked mutant sings a soft, wavering tune to herself. Yellow bruises discolor her skin, wounds formed not from violence but from malnutrition, and her prominent bones bend and twist at odd angles. Still, she smiles. She smiles at the oily water, devoid of any fish. She smiles as she arranges her empty basket beside her, and she smiles at you when she sees you standing over her. Hello, I am Crooked Qeek of the Cold Canyon Tribe. I haven't seen... That's a hell of a... You know... They really should have... Crooked Qeek of the Cold Canyon... Like, Cabal or something would be... Continue the alliteration there. I haven't seen you down here before. I hope you're not here to fish. They're nibbling instead of biting today. She coughs into her cupped hands, a raw and ragged hacking that bends her double. You take her for a child at first, but after studying her features, it's clear she's in her late teens. It's only some mutation, and her bony stature, born of starvation, that makes her seem childlike. You said you're part of the Cold Canyon tribe. Are they down here too? No, she says lightly. They're all gone. Either dead or gone, the headless guy. She still isn't meeting your eyes. There used to be a lot of us. We came here when I was a baby, running from... She pauses, thinking. A war. Some sort of war that never ends. My parents thought we would be safe here, but the tribe died off, one by one. She turns away, wiping her eyes. The city is hard on people like us. How is the city hard on your tribe? They were used to living in the wilderness, so they knew what they could eat safely. Here, it's not so simple. My mother told me that 10 people died eating tainted food before we found this fishing hole. She stares into the murky water. Then there's the diseases you can catch in the city. And the hate. A lot of us were killed just for being hard to look at, I guess. Is it as hard for you to survive here as it was for your people? No, she says, smiling. I don't have a lot to eat, but I'm more resistant to sickness than my parents were, and people here know me. They leave me alone. You said everyone in your tribe is dead? Not everyone, she says with a brave little smile. I'm here, and some of us just left for better places. I bet they're doing really well. Your real name is Crooked Qeek? Sort of. My parents call me Qeek, but my nickname came later. She hunches over, her eyes darting shadily from side to side. It's because I sell junk for high prices, and bribe the levies to carry people off in the night. No, not really. People call me Crooked because I look twisted and broken. She thinks, I wish they wouldn't, but it's okay. I am Crooked, right? Aw, she wishes they wouldn't call her that. Don't you mind that people call you Crooked? Not really. I can't call them liars, can I? She smiles, but it's not the radiant thing you saw before. Are you sure you don't mind that people call you Crooked? I do, she admits softly, but I won't be less crooked if they stop. Do you know where I might find a woman named Matkina? Matkina? That's not what people call her. She leans towards you, eyes as round as coins. They call her the White Death, she says. She's an assassin. I don't know where she is, and I hope I never do. Why are you scared of Matkina? They say... She begins, then drops her voice to a whisper. They say she can freeze your blood by speaking your name, and if you look her in the eyes, all of your hair will turn white. You don't really believe those stories about Matkina, do you? She blushes. No, she says, but she is a killer, and I... She bites her lip. I have a soft spot for scary stories. Why do you think the fish aren't biting? The fish down here are pretty fast and smart. They're nibbling at the bait, then swimming away. She watches the line with a combination of hunger and weariness. It's hard for me to get to the pole in time when the rod twitches, and harder to reel in the catch. I'm not very strong. Can I try fishing with your gear? Cool, gonna go fishing, guys. You're welcome to it, she says. Only if you do find something, could you share... She trails off, blushing. Never mind. Company is better than a scrawny fish. I'm gonna share. Come back anytime. Alright, let's see what we can do. We're gonna use some power to do this thing. Our, what is it? Speed, I'm guessing. Or maybe speed to catch it in time, and then might to pull it in. This thin, glowing thread pierces the surface of the water and plunges deep into the black depths like a white line drawn in shining ink. Examine. You try flicking the shining string, and your finger goes right through it. Could you try catching something for me? I've had no luck today. Besides, everything down there is pretty much stronger than me. I already said I would. Try catch something. You pull on a line, and something in the dark water, in the dark below, pulls back. You press your lips together and reel in the catch. A muddy cipher dangles from the end of the line. Huh. Would she have any use for this? She wants food. It's beautiful! Crooked Qeek breathes. I was just hoping for fish. I can sell it and eat for weeks. Let's give it to her. We better get gold for this. Nice. Small amount. You pass the cipher to her and she squinches her eyes shut in unmitigated joy. Thank you. Use my fishing pole whenever you want. Yeah, she needs it more than we do. Tug on the line. You take hold of the fishing rod and begin reeling in the line. But nothing is on the hook. You might have better luck tomorrow. Tomorrow. I guess we have to sleep and then try again. Otherwise we can keep getting that. See if she has anything else to say. I wonder what she found. She looks up at you with a dazzling smile, but not fast enough to conceal the sorrow that was on her face before. What's new? Oh. I thought she would talk about the thing we found. I don't eat often, but I don't beg neither. Oh, we've got a changing god cultist down here. We've got some strange crap going on over there. Leave me be. The cultist glances over at you casually. His eyes widen when they reach your face. I heard you intended to explore the city, but never imagined you'd find your way down here. What an honor. He folds his hands before him. How can I help you, beloved vessel? Let's examine him first. The man is pale, dirty, and nerve. Okay, my recording software crashed, so let's try this again. Examine. Oh, I can't get it back. Damn it. He fidgets, scratching his oily nose. Oh well. I'm gonna go back and watch the video to see what this read what the description is after I'm finished with this episode. So if you guys want to go back and pause, whatever like that, you can do the same. I am helping Fulsom discover who killed his protege. Have you seen anything? I haven't, he says, his brow creased with regret, but I will absolutely tell you if I do. I'm looking for a woman named Metkina. Have you seen her? The cast-off? Not recently, but she does work with Fulsom from time to time. He may know where she is. Farewell. To you as well, beloved vessel. Now what the hell is this?
On it.
We're on it. A dark sphere inhabits almost every socket in this obelisk that stretches toward the cavernous ceiling. No one seems to be paying the odd structure any attention. Like most Numenera, it is simply here, and if it can't be used, it's treated as part of the scenery. The orbs gleam in the dim light. You lean toward them. Are they glass? Jewels? Eyes? That's what I originally thought. Eyes. They keep, like, poking in and out of those things. Huh. Perception check. A flicker from one of the orbs above you catches your eye. You look up just in time to see the image of a woman leaning toward the surface of the glass from the inside. Touch the nearest sphere.
I'm ready to learn something new.
Cool. Someone leveled up. Your finger barely grazes the glass before it displays the image of a furred creature, touching the surface from the other side. Purple vines, threaded with veins of light, hang from the branches of the trees behind it. You lift your fingertip, and darkness swallows the creature. The orb is opaque once more. The orbs appear to reflect whatever action is performed in front of them. Rude gesture. Hum a little song. Red tide. Nothing appears in any of the dark orbs. Instead, the whisper of many voices joined in song curls from the obelisk so low that only you can hear it. Tell the orb a secret. With your lips nearly brushing the surface, you whisper a thought you've never told anyone. A too tall, narrow-hipped building. A visitant, appears in the glass, long fingers clasped. Meeting your eyes, it speaks words you cannot hear.
I'm ready to learn something new.
You can, however, sense its thoughts. They tickle an odd part of your mind. Dizziness overcomes you. You suddenly know that the visitant speaks stolen words and that blood was spilled to take them. Even though the cause was just, the visitant is deeply ashamed. It fades into the black of the orb, lowering its head. Speak stolen words. Blood was spilled to take them. It knows... It might... Well... Either know... It knows or has witnessed some part of the murder. Touch the nearest sphere again. The furred creature you saw before touches the orb again, bewildered. I gotta do this, guys. Make a rude gesture at the structure. Red again. You make the most obscene gesture you can think of at the glass. A young woman with rainbow pupils appears in the glass, flicking her fingertip across her chin. She nods, grinning, as if imagining your shock at her daring. Eritus says, "She insulted us! With her finger!" She shakes his fist at the glass. "Come out and do that again! I dare you!" A towering creature of flesh and crystalline muscle shakes a glittering fist back at him. Aha! Another challenger! Come out of there, you cowards! I'll fight you one by one or all together! Oh, you think so? Everyone was seeing is probably long dead. You tell them, Eritus. He glares at the now dark glass and snorts. Hiding in the dark, eh? I thought so. I want to know what happens. I can't make an even ruder gesture at the structure. I don't like raising red tide, necessarily, but... The rainbow-eyed woman rewards her gesture with one of her own. She jabs a finger at her knee, grinning at her own audacity. Calistige says, "Feel better, dear?" Alright, we're done. That was weird. So we can level up two people.
Yeah.
I see now this thing. The pluses. I didn't notice that before. So I'm not sure if I just never noticed it. Or if it's with this new version. Which is 1.02. 1.0.2. Okay. Improved ability. Oh, we can't. We can only do these. Edge and effort. Edge provides a bonus to all tasks and challenges that use a particular stat. For each point of edge in that stat, you can use one level of effort at no stat pool cost. Edge also reduces the activation cost of abilities, eventually making some free to activate. I'm going to do this extra effort first, though, because we can use that for anything, right? Okay. And Tiber. Sucker punch. Done.
You know, Alex, you should settle down. Make a little town of yourselves. You could even raise a barn or two. Maybe next to a babbling brook.
I've already heard enough babbling.
Awesome. For good kick. What? What do you want? I look like I'm not busy? You know what I'm doing. Do you? Allegern. A pair of gauntlets sits on the table. They look as though they're intended to provide real-time analysis and physical monitoring of any human arm placed inside. Allegern. Wasn't he up in the what do you call it, of truth? Don't you love? I swear we've talked to this Allegern before. Let's look at all this stuff first. On the shelf is a collection of wafer-thin slides containing cross-sectional cuts of living tissue. Some of the flesh still squirms. This machine collects and collates a variety of samples, preparing a full analysis of their physical, psychic, and dimensional properties. This device appears to store nanospirits and states of energy. It is dusty and unused. Allegern. I know that name.
I've already told you. I want nothing to do with this... Harridan. But you bring her to my door, ditch her someplace, and then maybe we can talk.
He thinks it's encouraging to note I don't miss her at all. Until then, peddle yourself somewhere else. I don't know what he's talking about.
I told you, I won't speak to you whilst you have her in tow.
Duh!
You talk so badly. Ditch her first.
He glares at Callistes. He's from the beginning. Of course. In the beginning, guys, in case you forgot, like I momentarily did, you meet Allegern and Callistes. And at some point you have to choose between the two of them. I chose Callistes. So that's where we know him from. Interesting. Mutant. This place is big. You gotta be tough to run a bush and ash down here, even if your bonish are make of glass. Oh, a bishnish. If you pay your fish on time, the thugs don't bother you. Alright, so... This is McKellar's up here. But we haven't gone up this way. We haven't seen what's down here, or in there, or up in there. Yeah, but I have to sign off. I don't want to stop, but I must. So tune in next time when we speak with Month Pa. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time and endure. And enduring, grow strong.